Good morning. Good morning. Well, we're going to ask if you stand with us. We want to welcome you, whether you are joining us here live in person or you're joining us online. We are just so thankful that you are here with us. We want to invite you to worship with us. Put your hands together just like this. As we like to lift up our praise and our worship to our Heavenly Father this morning. God is good, isn't He? Come on. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. you've done for me. We thank you so very much. Can we put our hands together and say thank you, Jesus? Thank you for your gift of salvation. Thank you for your love, that you love us so very much. God, we thank you so much. Lord, we thank you, God, that we can worship you today, Father, knowing how much you loved us, for the gift of your sacrifice. God, we thank you. Can you thank him this morning? Lord, we thank you. Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. Thank you, Jesus. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. I am. Oh, I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we before we say a word. You're the good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Can hardly think as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, 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 love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. Are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who I am. It's Exalt you, Jesus. Praise your name. Thank you, God. And I will exalt you. Sing it with me. I will exalt you. so good. Father, we thank you that every single day of every single moment, we have an opportunity to meet with you. We have an opportunity to talk with you. Father, we thank you that you are that close, God. That, Father, that we can be here to honor and praise you. But, Lord, that we can also have a personal relationship with you. And we are so thankful for that. Lord, and I thank you that you've allowed us the freedom to even be here this morning, that we can corporately, Lord God, lift our voices of praise and worship and thankfulness and adoration to you this morning. We thank you for that, God, that we can be one voice lifting our praises up to you together, Lord. So we thank you, God, for this opportunity, Lord God. We thank you, Jesus, for the opportunity to have that relationship with you. Can you sing that with me again? I will. And I will exalt you. I will exalt you. I will exalt you. You are my God. Because you're with me. Because you're with me.
Thank you, Lord.
Because you're with me.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Because you're with me.
We need not fear.
I will not fear.
Do not fear.
Man, the Lord says to you and me today, as he said to the children of Israel, you can know it, you can take a hold of it today as his son, as his daughter, through the covenant that we have through the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, so do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed or discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, I will help you, I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Do not fear, do not fear. Thank you, Lord.
We say thank you, Lord. Don't know where we'd be without you. You are with us through the rivers and the fires. Every storm, you're right there.
Well, God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. Can we do that as the psalmist said, as David said, and in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied as with the richest of foods, and with singing lips my mouth will praise you. Thank you, Lord.
We say we love you, Lord. I will exalt you. Tell them again.
I will exalt you.
I will
exalt you.
Nobody can sing it for you today.
You are my God.
God, I exalt you.
I will exalt you.
Lift your voice and your hands to the King of Kings.
I will exalt you.
He not only made you, he loved you so.
I will exalt you.
Tell him from your heart.
You are my God.
Father, thank you that we need not fear. We need not be afraid today. We thank you, Lord God, that when we're even too weak to hold on to you, we thank you that you've got us. You're holding us. You're holding us, Lord, and it's only because of your gracious, strong, and loving hand, oh God, that we are where we are today, Lord. God, thank you that you have kept us, you have protected us, you have provided for us, Lord, even when we did not acknowledge you or know you. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we say thank you today. And Father, today we lift up needs before you, Lord. And we thank you that even before we lift up a need before you, Lord, you know every word completely on our tongues, oh God. You know every prayer, oh God, before we utter it, Lord. You know everything about us, oh God. And you desire that, Lord, we would call upon you in faith, in humility, and in trust today, that we would call upon you in truth, Lord. So, Father, today we come to you in the name of your Son, your one and only Son, Jesus, who loved us, who lived for us, died for us, and rose from the dead for us, who's even now making intercession for us. And we thank you that it gives us great hope and confidence in prayer, that we can know that whatever we ask, Lord, whatever we ask, as we ask according to your will, Lord, we know that we have it, Lord. Not our will, then, we pray today. Not our will be done, but your will be done today. We pray, let your will be done today in Raquel Hernandez. God, bring healing and wholeness to her body today in the name of Jesus. We pray for Kelly today, for this young woman, oh God, who's gone through these surgeries and procedures, oh God. We pray in the name of Jesus, your will would be done. You would glorify your name and you'd bring healing to her body, oh God, in the name of Jesus. We pray for Marilyn Williams today, oh God, in the name of Jesus, oh God, bring healing and strength and wholeness and peace today in body, mind, and spirit. Do a miracle, we ask, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, for our brother Anthony today, for our brother Howard Hochberg today, for Vinny today, Lord, we pray that you would reach down, oh God, use the doctors, use the nurses, use the technicians, use the medications, oh God, but Lord, most of all, that you would reach down and you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, would do something so amazing, so miraculous, that every eye, every ear, every heart would know this had to be God. This had to be God. So Father, glorify your name in their situations today, we pray. God, we pray for Philip today once again. In the name of Jesus, oh Lord, send forth your word, oh God, and heal, Lord. Send forth your word, oh God. We know you're not bound, oh God, by geography, by location, oh God. In the name of Jesus, do it, we ask, oh God. And Lord God, may it be for your glory, your honor, Lord, as you see fit, oh God, according to your plan, your purpose, oh God. Lord, glorify your name in Philip's situation, oh God. Father, for our brother Cecil today, in the name of Jesus, that you'd reach down. You would touch him. You would encourage him. You would strengthen him today. In the name of Jesus, we pray, oh God. And Father, for this man Ron today once again. Father, in Jesus' name, you know his situation. You know his home, his marriage. You know everything about him, oh God. And Lord God, as we've been praying as a church for Ron, Lord, we pray once again that you would glorify your name. You'd bring healing and wholeness, Lord. And you would do that, oh God, which would most bring, oh God, most eyes, most hearts to you in Ron's situation. Lord, we pray for each of these today, God, that they would not only know your physical touch, but they would know your spiritual touch in their lives, and they would surrender and say yes to you, Jesus. Not just them, but they and their households, oh Lord. And Father, today we continue to pray for our president, President Trump today, that you would continue to lead him and guide him at this stage of his journey in all that, Lord, you've called him to do, oh God. We pray that, Lord, he would surrender everything to you. Everything to you, oh God. We pray you'd surrender his life. He'd surrender, Lord God, every part of himself, Lord God, that he would see and he would know who he is in light of who you are, Lord God. And Father, you would touch him today. Grant him wisdom. Grant him strength in all that he has before him at this stage. And we continue to pray now, oh God, also for President-elect Biden, oh God, in the name of Jesus, for him and Lord God, for Kamala Harris, oh God. We pray in the name of Jesus that you would touch them, oh God. That, Lord, you would grant them all that they have need of. God, grant them humility before you. Grant them a dependence upon you. Grant them, we pray, for all of these serving in office, oh God, now and to come. Grant them a fear of the Lord, for we know that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. So, Lord, we pray, not our will, not man's will, but your will be done in this nation and around this globe today. God, be with those that are serving you in areas that are tough to serve you, Lord God. Lord God, whether it be in India today, oh God, or Lord God, in various nations around the world, North Korea, Lord Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you would grant Lord God, strength and courage and power, Lord God, and even perform supernatural signs and wonders, Lord God, for our brothers and sisters that are serving you in the midst of persecution, oh God. Be with them, we ask, oh God. Anoint and use the missionaries, oh God, that both we support and those that we don't, Lord. But Lord, they're doing your work today. Be with them, we ask. Lord, have your hand upon us as your church. We declare our dependence upon you. We need you, Lord. We say, let it be so. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Tell them once again, I will.
I will exalt you.
I will.
I will exalt you.
Only you.
I will exalt you.
Yes, you are.
You are my God.
Tell them because you're with me.
Because you're with me.
Aren't you thankful for that?
Because you're with me. Because you're with me.
I will not fear.
I will not fear. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, go ahead. Lord, we give you all the applause today. We give you all the praise today. We give you all the worship today, Lord God. We say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Aren't you thankful to be in God's house today? Amen? Amen. Why don't you turn around to somebody nearby you, give them a fist bump or a wave or a hi. Maybe say hi to somebody new that maybe you've never met before.
Well, have you ever been in a situation where no matter what you said to someone, no matter what you thought, the other person just did not see it the same way. They just did not see it the same way. I know you guys are going to be lost now. You're going to be so lost in this behind me. Now, while you continue to fix your gaze on the screen, however you're watching this, truth be told, my wife and I, we sort of go through this all the time, all the time. And I'm not saying anything, you know, that's somehow divulging confidential information, okay? It's what makes for an exciting marriage. Perhaps for her, it makes for a frustrating marriage. But once again, it's depending on whose point of view you're watching this from, right? You're seeing this from. She might be convinced that there's something that we need, something that we need to do. And I, on the other hand, don't necessarily see it the same way. I don't have the same conviction, the same passion about it. I just don't feel the same way about something that she might be really passionate about, really feeling like we need or we need to do, something that's a deep conviction in her soul. And to be real, it's in those moments where she's feeling really passionate about it, really convicted about it, and I'm not really feeling that same conviction to do something or to maybe get something or buy something, whatever it might be. It's in those moments that, well, you know what happens. You know what happens. I mean, it definitely has the makings of well, sort of a breakdown in the relationship, doesn't it? It really does. I mean, in those moments, it's just so hard. Now it's like, oh. And it leaves, again, you know, me either wondering, why is she being so emotional about this? Why is she so dead set on this? Right, hon, I mean, this is, yeah, right? And it leaves her wondering if there will ever come a day in eternity when I will finally listen to what she's saying. Yeah. Yeah. I understand. Needless to say, it's the ability to listen to each other. To listen to each other, to understand why something is or isn't so important to the other person that really is so key, really to a good marriage. Here you are, Dixon and Ruth, your first Sunday back, and we're talking about marriage, right? It's really so key, listening to the other person, trying to understand why is this so important to her? And why isn't this something that's a priority to him or to her or vice versa? And again, you know, I can say, I love you, honey, you know, all I want. And she can say back to me, well, I love you more. And I can say back to her, no, I love you more. And then she can say, no, I love you mucho, mucho. And then I can say, no, I love you mucho, mucho, mucho. And she can say, no, I love you mucho. All right, you get it. You get it. I know you're like, okay. I get it. You know, here's the thing, folks. We can say I love you to each other all we want. But unless we're willing to listen to each other and willing to get out of our sort of comfort zone, as I'll say, the way that we are used to seeing things and understanding things, and try to finally understand why something is or is not so important to the other person, we might say, I love you, but our actions are actually undermining our words. Folks, love is more than a word. It's more than a feeling. It's a choice that we make to give up what is convenient and comfortable for ourselves in order to serve and benefit someone else. And that not only applies to marriage, does it? That applies to every relationship. Every relationship. So as we continue journeying through the Apostle Paul's letter, his epistle to the first century church at Rome, talking about a faith that changes everything. Today I want to talk with you about a faith that changes the way you love. A faith that changes the way you love. Now hang tight with me as we go through a portion of Scripture together. Picking up at Romans chapter 14, verse 1, we read, "As for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. One person believes he may eat anything, while the weak person eats only vegetables. Let not the one who eats despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats, for God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One person esteems one day as better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God, while the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of a brother. I know and am persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it unclean. For if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. By what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom Christ died. So do not let what you regard as good be spoken of as evil, for the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Whoever thus serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So then let us pursue what makes for peace and for mutual upbuilding. Do not, for the sake of food, destroy the work of God. Everything is indeed clean, but it is wrong for anyone to make another stumble by what he eats. It is good not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything that causes your brother to stumble. The faith that you have, keep between yourself and God. Blessed is the one who has no reason to pass judgment on himself, for what he approves. But whoever has doubts is condemned if he eats, because the eating is not from faith. For whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. Let's pause and pray once again. Father, thank you for your word, Lord. We pray even now in these next few moments, God, that you would begin to bring an understanding. You would begin to bring a clarity. God, that you would give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and hearts to believe and understand your word, that we might be doers of your word, not simply hearers of it. And Father, I declare my dependence upon the anointing of your Holy Spirit, not just for myself, but each one in the sound of my voice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we've seen already in our study of the book of Romans, Paul is writing more than simply to give us a comprehensive work on New Testament theology, as we call it, although he certainly does that in the process. Instead, he's writing to deal with practical issues, very practical issues that the church at Rome is dealing with, particularly, as we've seen, issues between Jews and Gentiles. Between Jews and Gentiles. Issues that are producing strife, tension, division. So if there's anything that he wants the church to be reminded of, it's that they are called to love one another. Love one another. Tell your neighbor, we are called to love one another. Sound familiar? Sound familiar? Oh, yes. What was it that Jesus said something about, by this all men, all people will know that you're my disciples? By your preaching? By your great music and singing? By your, you know, magnificent structures and buildings? No, by your love for one another. By your love for one another. But how? How does that love show up in the church? How does love show up in our relationships with each other? Does it show up by praying for each other? Yes, it does. By bearing one another's burdens? Yes. By serving each other? Well, yes. Does it show up by giving to one another in times of need? Yes, it does. And I'm so thankful, might I say, and just blessed as a church, that we're part of a church family where even this past week, we were able to be a blessing to a family going through financial hardships. That's what we're called to do. Is that the way that we love one another? Yes, that's a huge part of it. Does it show up how we share with one another? Yeah, we've talked about that. Even as we've gone through this study in Romans and even looking back at the early church, that one of the first ways that they began to put Jesus' words into actions of loving one another was by sharing with one another. Sharing with one another. But as we read in our passage, there's more to it. Somebody say, there's more to it. According to Paul, you are called to love others even when they don't see things the way that you do. Even when they don't see things the same way that you do, right in the church. Have you ever looked at something or watched or ate something and you thought one thing and then somebody else came along and they thought something, you know, just totally the opposite. It was the same experience, the same thing. Maybe you came out of seeing a movie and it was a good movie, you know, and you said, you know, this was a great movie. Wow, the plot line, the action, this and that. And you're like, oh, this was definitely worth seeing. And then somebody else came along and they're like, I really didn't like it. It was sort of boring. boring. What? You know, it was riveting. I mean, boy, the acting and the plot and everything. Or maybe you had a meal and it was, to you, it was just delicious. I mean, this was, oh boy, you know, that person, they just won your heart in that moment, you know? I mean, it was delicious. And then somebody came along and had the same meal and they're like, oh no, put it away, please, you know? No elbowing anybody, okay? Maybe you were in a situation, okay, where, you know, somebody was eating a particular food in front of you, and, you know, you heard it was a little spicy, and you asked that person, is it hot? Is it spicy? And they're like, nah, not really. Not really. You know where I'm going with this. And then all of a sudden you decide to take, you know, a forkful and plus mouthful. You're like, oh, okay, great. Boom. And the next thing you know is your head feels like it's on fire. You can find, like, no solace, no refuge anywhere. It was just, again, for them, it wasn't that spicy. Nelson, it wasn't that spicy for him. But for the rest of us human beings on planet Earth, it's spicy, really spicy. Listen, the fact is that no two people will always, right, see things the same way. No two people. And that's okay. Somebody say, that's okay. Because for a lot of us, it's not okay. It's my way or the, yeah. That's okay. It's okay. But it's not just about movies and foods, you know, that we're talking about here today. I'm talking about people, yes, even people right in the church, people who love Jesus and who want to serve him, will not always see eye to eye on some of the deepest issues, the deepest matters of life and faith. And they won't always see things the same way. And what is it? That's okay. That's okay. In fact, this is where the rubber hits the road, as they say, in our Jesus walk. This is where it really counts. This is where our love for God and others is truly put to the test. In fact, if we don't get this right, if I could just put it this way, if we don't learn how to love one another right in the church with all of our different convictions and perspectives on things, we might as well pack up things and head home right now. And I really mean that. I really mean that. Because if we can't love one another right in here, there's no way that we're reaching people out there. And thank you to some of you who are here today, that this is brand new for you. This is maybe your first time in a church or in a setting like this. And thank you for being with us. The church family, if I could just talk to you, if we can't get this one right in here, people are very quickly going to notice, I don't want to be a part of that in there. For what? To bring them into a divided church? Why would anyone out there want to be a part of what's happening in here when they see how unloving and judgmental we can be toward one another? Now, let me just pause. Let me just make a... This message is not because I'm noticing something right now in the church that needs addressing, like Paul's addressing the church at Rome. But I want to be faithful to preaching God's word. And if God's word speaks to it, then I know it's worth speaking. Amen? So praise God, I've not seen a lot of what I'm talking about, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Especially in here. For all of us. For all of us. When we ignore our call to love others who see things differently than we do, we're not only missing the heart of God, but we're actually putting into practice some of the very same behaviors that a band of ruthless religious leaders exercised against a man that they simply could not see eye to eye with. That man I'm talking about was Jesus. Jesus. They couldn't see eye to eye with him. No way. So he ended up on a cross. As we look closer at our passage at hand, talking about a faith that changes the way you love, I want you to notice what this passage is not saying in order that we can clearly see what it is saying, and ultimately in order that you and I can love one another in the way that God has called us to, in the way, as Paul says, that is for the glory of God, for the glory of God. Notice number one, this is not about accepting sin, but others. This is not about accepting what God's word clearly says is wrong. A lifestyle that's clearly wrong. Behaviors that are clearly wrong. A heart condition, an attitude that's clearly wrong. This is not about accepting sin, but others. Paul is not writing to say that you and I ought not to judge and properly evaluate things in life. We have to evaluate things in life. We have to judge and discern things in life and distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. We can't simply check our heads at the door and say, oh, God doesn't want me judging anything, so I'm not. No. When Jesus talks about not judging, he's talking about not to condemn the person's heart. Not to somehow say, I'm better than them, and they must be like this. But that's not saying don't judge the fruit of what's going on in a person's life. That's not to say don't evaluate something as right or wrong. Again, especially if it's clearly defined in God's word as sin, as wrong in his eyes. So this is not about excusing sin. Instead, Paul is dealing with issues that we often refer to as matters of conscience. Matters of conscience. Something that has not been clearly spelled out in the Bible as right or wrong, nor is there a biblical principle that would speak either for or against it in every circumstance. So it's left up to the conscience of the individual to determine if for them, if for her, if for him, it's right or wrong. Does that make sense? It's left up to the conscience of the individual before God with the Holy Spirit at work as a follower of Jesus in your life to make that determination. Now, having your ringer on in church, that's wrong. Okay, I'm just kidding. Just had to say that. Okay. It's left up to the individual, to their conscience as they surrender their hearts and minds and life to God, to the work of the Holy Spirit. What was obviously going on in the church at Rome, remember we talked about there was this expulsion of the Jewish community there in Rome, and now they had returned, and it wasn't long after their return that now Paul is dealing with issues between Jews and Gentiles there in the Roman community. But what's obviously going on there at the church in Rome is there were Jewish believers who had great difficulty with certain things that the Gentile believers were doing. They had great difficulty eating certain foods, especially certain meats and other foods and drink offered to idols. This would just be a common part of the practice there in the community, in the marketplace. No, listen, in case you misread this passage, this wasn't about like God saying you should be a vegetarian or not. Okay, this was not about going vegan or not. That's not what this is about. Again, as he addresses areas and issues that have to do with being a vegetarian, it's because they said, no, I can't eat that meat because that meat is somehow polluted by idols. And we can't do that. Not as a good Jew. I can't, in good conscience, eat that food. I can't do that. So no, this wasn't about being a vegetarian or not. And folks, guess what? This wasn't really about drinking wine or not. That's not what he's talking about. Once again, it has to do with, again, certain drinks and foods being offered, just commonplace there in the culture to certain idols. And instead, the problems that Paul is discussing have to do with these Gentile practices that were offensive to Jewish believers, things that were tied to this idolatrous culture around them. And not only that, but the Jewish believers also had great difficulty with doing certain things on certain days like the Gentiles in the church. It's causing an internal conflict for them. This is problematic. What they saw happening in their congregation was against everything that they knew as the people of Israel. You don't do that on this day. These are holy days. This is a set apart day. You can't do that, no. And it was vexing to them. It troubled their consciences. So for them to eat certain foods, for the Jewish believers there to eat certain foods, for them to observe, again, to ignore the observance of certain days, it was wrong. To eat certain food and drink and to not observe certain days, it was wrong for them as Jewish believers, followers of Messiah Jesus. Now, was it wrong because God said now it was wrong for them in Jesus? Well, no, not exactly. Not now. Maybe back then, maybe back in the Hebrew scriptures, back in the Hebrew Bible, they had all sorts of laws that they had to follow. But now in Jesus, everything changed. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Jesus came not to abolish the law. He came as the fulfillment of the law, all of the laws. He came as the fulfillment. Jesus changed everything. And folks, let me just say to you today, if you came here just looking for more, you know, religion and more regulations and do's and don'ts, you came to the wrong place. You came to the wrong place. This is about a relationship with God. That he has opened up heaven's gate to you and me through his son who went to the cross out of love for you and me. It's about a relationship with him. Even still, these convictions were deep in the hearts of the Jewish believers. Everything might have been new in Jesus, but they couldn't just, and I've seen believers go through this time and again, and some of you right here in this room, where you're like, I know that it's not, you know, wrong for everybody, but I just can't get away from this. I just can't. This is something I just don't feel right with. It's not because the Bible says it's wrong. It's for you, you recognize that this is not right. And for the Jewish believers, they couldn't get away from the convictions that they knew, that they grew up with, that this is what they knew their whole life. They believed it was wrong, so for them it was wrong. It was wrong. Listen, once again, if you're looking for a one-size-fits-all type of religion where everybody is told by a pastor or everybody is told by a rabbi how to believe and what to do and what not to do in every detail and decision in life, you've come to the wrong place. You haven't come to a cult today, folks. You've come to Christ Jesus. Amen. Christ Jesus. You don't need a pastor or a rabbi or a religious leader telling you in every decision in life what to do and not to do. If that's the case, Jesus wasted his time living, dying, rising from the dead, ascended to the right hand of God the Father, and pouring out his Holy Spirit to the church to lead us and guide us into all truth. Why would he do that? If you can just go to a man who can tell you everything to do and not to do. That's not why you're here. Tell your neighbor, that's not why you're here. You see, our walk of faith is exactly that, a walk of faith. Led by the Spirit of God, not simply the rules of God. Led by the Spirit of God, not simply the rules of God. And folks, let's just make it clear. When you and I are following the leading of God's Holy Spirit, he will lead us into all righteousness, into all truth. He will lead us, as he is, into holiness. Into holiness. Yes, obedience to God. Obedience to God is a must. Obedience to Jesus is a must. Jesus made it very clear that, again, you know, the person who loves him will obey what he commands. But even then, folks, listen, there are things that Jesus will ask of me that he might not be asking you. Not because I'm better. No, we'll talk about that in a moment. He will ask of me certain things that he might not ask of you. And this is where I like it too. He will ask of you certain things that he will not ask of me. And he will ask certain things of you that he won't even ask the person sitting next to you. And he will ask the person sitting next to you some things that he won't ask you. And then he'll ask, well, you get it. You get where I'm going. Why? Because God's Holy Spirit is at work in us individually. I love it on the day of Pentecost that, again, as the Holy Spirit just blew into that room and they saw what appeared to be like tongues of fire resting upon just one of them? No, upon each of them. And they all spoke with tongues, these other languages as the Spirit enabled them. God was at work in each of them, although corporately, but still individually. And that's what he still does today. God desires to work in your life individually and in mine, although he works in us corporately as well. And folks, guess what? When God is asking something of me that he's not asking of you, and when he's asking something of you and there are things for me that are wrong, but for you, they're not wrong. For you that they're not wrong. And I'm like, man, that's frustrating. That's frustrating. You know, why does she get that freedom? Why does he have that freedom in this right now? Guess what? I have to accept that. I have to accept that. I have to accept you. And isn't this the heart of what Paul is saying here? I am called to accept you. And let's be real. Sometimes it's easier to accept the person than it is to accept their faith, or might I say, their belief on what might be considered a controversial matter. It's easier to accept the person oftentimes than a person's belief or faith on a matter that seems to be a controversial one. It's easy to say so-and-so is a really great guy, but it's also easy to say, yeah, and you know, there's obviously something wrong with his faith, you know, because if there wasn't, he wouldn't be doing that. Because, you know, for me, that's obviously wrong. And so if he really loved God, he wouldn't be doing that thing right now. Again, remember, we're not talking about sin. We're not talking about something that's been clearly defined in God's word as right or wrong. But for, it's a matter of conscience right now. And I'm like, oh, but for me, I'm just not. But for them, they're okay with that. It's easy to say she's a fantastic person, isn't she? But then to go on to say, but between you and me, if she really loved the Lord, she wouldn't see it that way. You might say, he has a great heart, but if he was a bit more mature in the faith, if he was a bit more, and he really loved Jesus, he wouldn't have voted like that. Now I just got into meddling. Come on, you know it's real. You know it exists right here. You know it is. I love it because this room is full of every party. Every party. But I pray it's full of one family. The family of God in Christ Jesus. He would have voted like whom? Like me. He would have voted like me. Once again, as you look closely at what Paul is saying, you realize that this is not about accepting sin, whether in your own life or in the lives of others. This is about accepting and welcoming others in the body of Christ, the church, just like this one, regardless of how differently they see things from you. Can you say amen? Amen. Noticeably, number two, this is not about being more spiritual, but sensitive. But sensitive. Why don't you turn to your neighbor and say, We could use a bit more sensitivity these days. And all the wives said, amen. Amen. I've gotten that lecture from male mentors in my life. It's called being sensitive, John. It's called being sensitive. Notice again what Paul says. Therefore, let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of a brother. And again, he goes on, for if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. By what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom Christ died. And again, we who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his who? Neighbor. For whose good? His good, to build him up. Folks, if you think, like many, many do, I'm afraid, that following Jesus is all about being able to do what you want, when you want, how you want, because after all, you're forgiven now, you're free in Jesus, you can just do whatever you want. Think again. Think again. No, you're not called to walk on eggshells. Can you hear them? Because a lot of us do that. Man, I've had to struggle through that, right? You just feel, what is this whole idea of walking on eggshells? It's an idiom that maybe for some of you it's a little far. Again, it's the idea that you're always walking around a little paranoid about what is somebody going to think of me? Or this person's going to be offended by what I say or what I do right now. God doesn't want you walking around like that. Why? Especially because it's oftentimes the same person who seems to be offended by everything that everybody does. You are called, though. You are called, and I am called, to be sensitive to the needs and convictions of those around you. You are called to be sensitive to the needs, to the convictions of those around you. You are called to think about how your actions are affecting people that are connected to you. How your actions are affecting people, maybe that God has called you to be a bridge to Jesus for. But maybe by the time they're done seeing you, by the time they're done watching your life, they're like, I don't know. Like, I wouldn't want to follow Jesus. It's just, sure, something might be fine for you to do, but that doesn't mean it's fine for you to do all the time, any time, or to post all over social media for everyone to see. Please use some wisdom in the body of Christ. We're called to be sensitive to one another, to the needs of others, where others are weak, where others are vulnerable. Please be sensitive. Once again, please hear me. I'm not advocating living a double life, whether you're living, you know, where you're living one way in public and then another way in private. That's not what I'm advocating. In fact, I am fed up with that type of life being lived, particularly those, once again, who are in the spotlight in Christianity. We're done with it. We don't need it anymore. We don't need it. Who were the people that Jesus had the toughest time with? The people that were known as the sinners in society and who came humbly and repentant before him? No. It was the people who claimed they were all that, and yet they were living double lives. And Jesus said, "You hypocrites, you brood of vipers." And Jesus never spoke more about hell than he did with religious people. About religious people. Again, I'm talking about being sensitive to others around you in those areas that are matters of conscience. Not just going on your merry way, thinking, I'll just do whatever I want to do, live however I want to live, say whatever I want to say. And for the person whose conscience allows them to do certain things unhindered before the Lord, they are what Paul refers to as those strong in faith. Strong in faith. And for the person whose conscience does not permit them to do such things, for whatever reason, because of their background, their upbringing, their experiences, they are what Paul refers to as those weak in faith. But here's a key thing to remember. To be, as Paul says, strong in faith is not a better faith. Please understand this. And to be weak in faith is not a deficient faith, but a different faith. Now, when we begin to understand this as he's writing, and you'll go home this week, God willing, and read back again Romans 14 and this portion of Romans 15, and you'll begin to understand, oh, wait a minute. I thought this, but I realize he's saying this. In fact, what's really interesting is that I wonder if we actually get this all wrong in the church, or at least we reverse things. What am I talking about? We usually think in terms of the person who's really strict, who can't do anything, who feels really, again, convicted about certain things, as the person who's really strong in their faith. They're the really spiritual one. The problem is that's not how Paul is using it. That's not how Paul sees it. Instead, he or she is what Paul calls weak. Again, not deficient, just different. Again, not in a bad way, but in a unique way. And what's even more interesting is that even though we usually have to deal in the church more with, well, conservative, stricter people, those whom Paul might call weak, being too harsh on those who feel at liberty to do certain things, Paul actually begins this section by challenging the more liberal ones. Isn't that interesting? He speaks to the more liberal ones. But notice, he doesn't challenge them by saying right away, stop what you're doing. He doesn't say, stop being so free in Jesus. Instead, he challenges them to accept or welcome those that are having a tough time with such liberties in Jesus. He challenges them, as this passage goes on, as we read, to stop judging and looking down on the more strict or the weak ones. How's that for a reverse? That's not how we usually handle it or do things. And he challenges them to be more sensitive to others, to even lay down their rights, their freedoms, and what they feel is just fine for them to do in Christ Jesus in order to build up others and remove any roadblocks, any stumbling blocks for these other believers, to remove anything that would cause them to be hindered in their faith, hindered in coming to Jesus and in continuing their walk in Jesus. You see, this is not about being more spiritual. This is about being more sensitive to others. Finally, notice number three. This is not about doing something easy, but difficult. Notice what Paul says. So then, let us pursue what makes for peace and for mutual upbuilding. What's really interesting here is that this word translated pursue is the term in the Greek there, dioko, which can mean to put to flight. It could be used negatively to persecute. And, of course, it means, as it's translated here, to pursue. In fact, it's the same term that Paul uses in his letter to the Philippians when he writes, not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I, what? Press on. It's this term here, dioko. I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his. And again, he says, I press on, the same term here, toward the goal for the prize for the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And what's interesting about this word here, dioko, is that it carries the idea of aggressively chasing after something, like a hunter pursuing its catch. And when I think of that, I can't help but think of our little dog once again. She's so cute. She's such a nice, sweet dog. But she is a hunter. A hunter. I had her out on the leash just about a week and a half ago, whatever it was. And there in the backyard, and all of a sudden, she's on the leash, has a harness on her. And all of a sudden, you know, she's only about like this big. You know, and spots a groundhog. She begins to spot it. She begins to move closer. Now I'm pulling, and there's a tension on the leash there. She's pulling, and all of a sudden, she now gets herself down in like this crouching position. She's crouching, and now her body begins to tremble, like shake and shake. I'm like, holy cow, this dog is about to explode, right? All of a sudden, like the groundhog begins to run toward the woods. We begin to move in a little bit, and the dog shoots out and all of a sudden chases down this ground. I mean, again, the groundhog had this huge lead, but could I tell you how fast this little dog is? Boom, it aggressively chases down this groundhog, knocks the thing to the ground. Don't worry, the groundhog's okay. Okay, the groundhog leg. It knocks the thing down, just sent it down. The dog didn't even know what to do with the groundhog at that point, and the groundhog went scurrying down its hole. The dog now is looking down its hole, and it's just looking up at me like, what did I just do? I'm telling you, it was like in another world. Like, I don't even know what I just did. It's just like instinct took over. My wife came in, she's screaming, no, not the groundhog, not Lucifer. We call the groundhog Lucifer, sorry. No, you know. She might not have said Lucifer at that point. I'm exaggerating just a little bit, but. Folks, Paul says to us that we are to pursue, we are to chase down, hunt down, aggressively go after what? what makes for peace and mutual upbuilding. He'll write elsewhere in one of his epistles, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit. It's as if Paul is saying that you and I have to be like that little dog when it comes to going after peace, when it comes to going after what's going to build up our brother or sister in Christ, what makes for peace and strengthens others in the church. And so often we just want to, you know, just do it our own way, handle it our own way, you know, say whatever we want to say, post whatever we want to post, you know, live however we want to live. And if somebody doesn't agree with me, well, that's their problem. That's their problem. Jesus said something about blessed are the peacemakers. We have to set our eyes like that little dog did on that groundhog on our objective. And go for it. Go after it. Chase it down aggressively. No matter what's happening. No matter who, might I say, no matter who's in office and who's not in office. Whether things are going our way or they're not going our way. Whatever it might be. No matter what. No matter who. No matter where. But I'll tell you, it's got to begin here. Here. In your heart and in my heart. You see, if you thought that loving others is easy, you better think again. Sure, loving others that see things exactly the way that you do. That's easy. That's easy. That's also not reality. That's not reality. Real life is about learning not simply to exist with others who don't see things the way that you do, but learning to embrace others that don't see things the way that you do. And folks, it's got to begin right here in the family of Christ. And you know what that means? I pray that you do. That means that this area of your faith, especially for some of you in this room or some of you watching today, this area of your faith could very well be one of the greatest tests that you'll ever face in your walk with Jesus. It will be one of the greatest tests, hardest, most difficult tests that you'll ever have to pass through. Why? Because your flesh, yes, even as a believer, wants to be right. Your flesh that battles with the Holy Spirit within you, rages war within you, it wants, it needs to be right. It needs to be right. And here's the reality. If you always need to be right, you're not only going to be a miserable believer, you're going to make everybody else in the church miserable as well. Please know that. If you always need to be right, you're not only going to be a miserable believer, but you're going to be making everybody else miserable in the church as well. But when you truly know who you are in Christ Jesus, that makes all the difference. That makes all the difference. You don't need to be right. Why? Because you know that you are right in Him. You don't need to be right because you know that, once again, He's made you right. That you're right with Him. And that's the most important thing of all. To be loved. To be accepted by Him. We sang it today. A good, good Father. A good, good Father. He loves us. He accepts us. Not because of who we are, but because of who Christ Jesus is and what He's done for you and me. And now He calls you to do the same for others, to love others the same way that He has loved you. Folks, it's time. It's time for the church to arise. To arise, not simply in how we vote, folks, but in how we love one another who have voted differently than us. I'll say it again. It's time for the church to arise, not simply in how we vote, but in how we love those who have voted differently than us. It's probably the person right next to you. That's where it really counts. It's time not to accept sin, but to accept one another, even with our different viewpoints and convictions. Not sin, matters of conscience. It's time to lay down our superiority complexes. our spiritual superiority complexes and take up our call to love one another by being more sensitive to one another in all that we do. And it's time to do that which very well might be the toughest thing that you'll ever face as a believer, especially the more that you grow, the more that you learn, the more that you know, to love those in the church who see things differently than you. It's time to love the way that Jesus has loved us. Would you bow your heads today? Would you bow your heads? For some of you today, I'm going to give you a very bold challenge. For some of you, as we're talking about this idea of being accepted by God, whether in song today, in lyric, or in the message from God's word, being accepted by Jesus, that the reproaches and the insults that should have been upon us were upon him, that he did everything necessary to demonstrate real love for us. For some of you, you've never accepted that love. You've never taken a hold of it. This might even be the first time you're hearing that God loves you, and he loved you so much that he sent Jesus for you. Jesus lived perfectly for you, because you and I could never. He died for you. He went to the cross and said, "It is finished," because he had paid in full the price for your sin and mine. And he rose from the dead, proving that he truly is the Son of God. And that because he lives, you and I could know that we will live also. We have the hope of eternal life and one day even a resurrection from the dead, as he himself has already experienced. God loved you. He loved you that much that he sent Jesus. But it's up to you to say yes to him. All across this room right now, you say, "Pastor John, I need God's forgiveness today. I've never said yes to Jesus, and today I realize God did that for me. Jesus did that for me. And I want to receive that in my life today. I want to receive Jesus in my heart, in my life today, and I want to live for him. I want to tell him thank you. Thank you for doing that for me." I'm going to ask you to do something very bold right now. On the count of three, I'm just going to ask you to stand to your feet all across this room. You'd say, "Pastor John, that's me." It's not about anybody pointing any fingers today or trying to sell you something today. This is about you making a bold stand before God to say, "Yes, God, I stand today. Count me in. I want to live for Jesus. Jesus, forgive me of my sin. I want to follow you." If that's you all across this room right now, I'm just going to count to three. When I do so, would you just stand? Whoever you are, wherever you're sitting right now, on the count of three. One, it's about you and God right now. Two, the Bible makes it clear we'll all give an account before him one day. And Jesus says, "I loved you that much. I gave my life for you. Receive me. Say yes to me now." That's you today. Would you stand on the count of three? Three. All across this room, even right now. You're standing and saying, "Yes, I need Jesus today. I want to receive him into my life, into my life." God sees you today. God sees you. More importantly than me seeing you today, God sees you. Others across this room right now, you're saying, "Yes, that's me. I need God's forgiveness. I want to say yes to Jesus. I want to say yes to Jesus." All across this room right now, you're saying yes. Those of you watching online right now, you can reach out to God right where you are, just saying yes, Jesus. Maybe you'll even stand where you are if you can. Saying yes, yes to him. Just begin to talk to him right now, wherever you are, whether you're standing or sitting, because I want to continue this challenge right now. But if you're standing right now, just begin to talk to him. Just begin to tell him, "God, thank you. Thank you for sending Jesus for me. Thank you for sending Jesus for me. Thank you for sending Jesus. Thank you for sending Jesus for me. Jesus, I say yes to you. Forgive me of my sin, Lord. I say yes to you." Some of you are in this room or watching today, and you've been hurt by others that have judged you. You've been hurt by those that thought they were doing the God thing when really they were just doing the hurtful thing. And what was really a matter of conscience, they took out on you as if you were breaking God's word. And folks, to tell you plainly, they were wrong. But it's left a wound and it's left a scar on your soul. And today you'd say, I need God's healing in my soul today. It has hurt me. And maybe you've lived with it for decades. I could just recount to you stories after stories of people that said things. They maybe meant well, and they might have even seemed like the spiritual ones in the church. But boy, they missed it. Because they were talking about matters of conscience, but they took it out as if it was God's word another was breaking. And you've been wounded, and today you need healing, and you want others to pray with you maybe today. I'm going to ask you to stand across this room right now. You say, Pastor John, that's me. I've been hurt. I've been wounded by others in the church that said things or did things. And folks, let me just say, I don't even take myself out of that equation. There's maybe even at times where inadvertently, I might have been that person. I might have been the one. Maybe it was years ago, somebody else, whatever it might be. You need God's healing today. We want to pray for you. You want to stand right now saying, yes, I need God's healing. Some of you need to stand right now because you've been the one that's been quick to pass judgment on others. And today you want to turn from that. You want to say, no more, God, forgive me for being the mouthpiece at times, really, of the enemy more than the mouthpiece of God. You've had in mind the things of man rather than the things of God. And you've expressed those things thinking you were doing the spiritual thing when once again, it was the hurtful. You need God's forgiveness today. I'm going to ask you to stand right now because you've been the one to pass judgment on others. Maybe in your heart, in your attitude, in your mind, or through your words. I want you to stand right now and just saying, yes, God. Be real enough today. Be honest enough today to deal with it between you and God. But I pray today you would take even a physical stand right now. You're standing saying, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for being that judgmental one. Forgive me, God, for insisting on others see it my way, do it my way, think about it my way. For others of you today, you've been ignoring how your actions have been affecting others. You actually might be the very reason that others are stumbling in their walk in Jesus. You might be doing something that for you, it's fine. You actually have that freedom between you and God. But the problem is your walk in Christ is not just between you and God. You're connected to people. You're connected to people. And some of your choices, while free in Jesus, have actually become a stumbling block for others. And it's causing others maybe to even go down a road that just been a dangerous, dangerous road now. Why? Because they've actually watched you. And they thought, well, I can do this too. But they couldn't. They couldn't. Truth be told, some of us might be free, but oftentimes we're also very selfish. Yes, we are. All of us. But today you want to make a turn. You want to make a turn. You want to say, Lord, God, forgive me for using my freedom in a way that's not been beneficial for others. Forgive me, God, for in any way being a stumbling block to others, Lord. Would you forgive me today for using my freedom, Lord God, in a way, Lord, that's not been glorifying to you? I'm going to ask you to stand right now, to be real enough today to stand across this room. And I'm going to invite you right now, wherever you're standing, for whatever reason today, I'm going to ask our prayer team if you just begin to come right now. Prayer team, would you begin to come? Thank you, prayer team. And as we, in just a few moments, will be dismissing and going out these doors today, I want you to know that there are others here today that are ready to pray with you. Maybe some of you were a little hesitant to stand for some things. Maybe, though, you would really want to talk with somebody and pray with somebody through some things. I'm going to ask you to stand all across this room right now. Would you stand all across this room? Would you pray with me even right now? Father, we thank you today. We thank you for meeting with us, God, through this time, Lord. We say yes to you, Lord. We say yes to you. We want to be a people that love you and love others well. We thank you for loving us. If you stood just a few moments ago because you were saying, I need God's forgiveness and I want to receive Jesus into my life, then I want you to tell him even right now, Jesus, thank you for loving me so much that you gave your all for me. Now today, I give my all back to you. I surrender my life to you. I trust in you, Jesus. I will follow you with your help and your spirit all the days of my life. Forgive me of my sin. Make me brand new. I thank you that on this day, November 8th, 2020, I became a part of the family of God. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Folks, let me remind you today, these altars will be open. These folks here have been praying for this service and praying for you, even though they might not have known you by name. Please, as others are heading out these doors in a few moments, please take time. There's somebody that you want to talk to, ask questions of. And please, if there are any questions during the week, you want to email me or reach out to the church in any way that I can help to answer any questions from the message today, please don't be bashful. Don't hesitate to reach out. Now let me bless you. Now go and make a difference this week by loving one another as Christ Jesus has loved you. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And everyone said, Amen. Amen. God bless you. Lord be with you.